Today's video mini lecture will provide a brief overview of the history of manga.
I am hardly a historian of manga, and today's lecture is entirely based on a chapter by Jean-Marie Bouissou, if I said that right. So, when did manga begin? Maybe the e-makimono, which are painted narrative scrolls, kind of like in the photo here. A famous early scroll is from the 12th century, but there are a lot of manga scholars who actually question this origin, and they point out the differences in the visual language between the e-makimono and manga. There are content similarities, like earthy humor and familiarity between humans and non-beings, but there are also dissimilarities, like in the graphical and narrative realm, where there really isn't much of an overlap between the two. In the Edo period, urban culture was rapidly developing. And some people see a connection between manga and the urban culture in that time period. Peace was restored, and there were a lot more cultural forms that were emerging in these increasingly prosperous cities. From around 1775 in the Edo period, there was a kind of cheap novel that emerged that also had illustrations, and they could sell 10,000 copies or more, which is really just amazing. Kabuki theater also may have influenced manga aesthetics. And it was when there was offset and lithography printing that graphic narration could become a low-cost mass media. And the first two illustrated magazines in Japan were actually published by two foreigners. In 1900, a weekly supplement in a newspaper called Jiji Manga appears. And this is the first time that we see manga being adapted as a title to talk about this format. Before that, people had been using other words. Manga actually means sketches that are made for fun out of this sudden inspiration or even derisory pictures. So it's not a very respectful term. We also see the first star mangaka or manga artists appear at this time. In the Taisho era, manga has become recognized as an important form, and we see newspapers and news magazines that are publishing manga quite frequently. It's used for political expression, and it's also, of course, mass entertainment. And the really interesting thing is right from the very beginning, we see that major Japanese publishing powerhouses are getting involved with manga. So the mainstream Japanese publishers really turned this into a mass industry. So by 1931, we see, 950,000 copies of a manga being produced and multiple versions of other manga. And so after World War II, having this sort of major industry support became a really important part of turning manga into a profitable industry and allowing it to expand. Manga expanded both as manga and as byproducts like movies and radio serials, anime and merchandise as well. So the Japanese mangaka, they originally were inspired more by American comics and cartoons with a lot of like very Disney-like graphics, but they developed these original themes and characters that became core components of manga. And so those are things like these young samurai that have supernatural powers, or children who are battling against international conspiracies, traveling through outer space. Also this strange, erotic, grotesque nonsense genre. Pre-war, and actually during the war, manga were forced to become much more nationalistic and pro-government if they wanted to keep being published. The government obviously saw the benefit in having a way to reach teenagers. So how did that manga become today's manga?
Most scholars actually talk about this enduring national trauma that Japan suffered after they lost their empire and they lost their war and were occupied by the United States for 7 years.
So it really changed manga into modern manga. People say that modern manga first appeared in 1947, and they often talk about Tezuka Osamu, who was able to really become a huge hit and adapt to changing trends in the manga industry for the rest of his life, really. So he got the nickname God of Manga. So he's credited with being the first one to use graphic techniques in imitation of cinema and to make story manga with really long, complex plot lines. Now, this generation of mangaka, like Tezuka, these are people who are teenagers during the war, and they were too young to fight, but they were old enough to really feel this trauma of being defeated. And this trauma brought four major elements to manga, according to scholars. So first, there's this scenario of adult failure, where young people have to save the world. Second, there's this mecha genre, which is, you know, pilots and, you know, outer space issues. And then there's this scientific adventure genre. And then there's this sort of influence of having the U.S. occupation with the kind of clash between traditional values and new values that are being imported. So there's a lot of complex life lessons in manga and a much more dramatic tone than you see in a lot of the Western comics of this era. So the post-war manga developed into two main types: series for kids and these cheap red books. The Akabon had a dark, hard artistic style called Gekiga, which became much more important in later manga. And there was also a third type of manga, which was this paper theater, a street performance where somebody would narrate a series of pictures at a time period when publishing many copies of manga was difficult because of a lack of paper. The period from 1959 to 1990 is the period where manga readership went from just being something for schoolboys to being something that everybody in Japan did. In 1959, the baby boomers were getting past the traditional age for reading manga. They had more spending money than they'd ever had before, and the publishers wanted to keep them reading. Although the more prosperous times and the increase in television programming had led to a reduced readership for the dark adult comics, as the baby boomers entered university and got involved in things like student protests, then manga needed to be as rebellious as the readers. And so most of the major magazines then moved back towards these dark adult comics and away from Disney-esque children's comics. There were a lot of manga that broke all sorts of social taboos, and the major publishers were very tightly involved with things like the flagship weekly Shonen Jump, which is still important today. Also at the same time period, shoujo, or girls comics, which are developing as their own genre, and instead of having men continue to be the writers and illustrators, now women are taking this over, and they're bringing in new aesthetics and, you know, sort of a feminine vision of love and sex. And they even include, of course, women's problems like pregnancy and rape. And this is the topic for a later class, so I won't talk more about it. But the manga industry also continued
to move towards segmenting the market in various ways. So they had young men's manga, and they had salarymen manga, and office ladies manga. And then all of these different subgenres of manga emerged, as you can see on the screen. And so manga really diversified and sought to attract people who are interested in this form of storytelling, no matter what their age and no matter what their occupation was.